Our guests are from a variety of businesses. They are from the construction industry. They are into the stock market. They were also venturing into the airlines industry. They had an airlines license also. And at the same time, they are also into the power generation business. Very interesting, multifaceted couple. Both have been IRS officials. Mr. Dharmendra Mehta has been from Mumbai, but now he has been staying in Mangalore. Giselle Mehta is from Mangalore. Both met during their training period in 1990. Mr. Dharmendra Mehta has also been a chartered accountant by qualification. During his working as a chartered accountant, he interacted a lot with the Indian revenue officials. And at that time, he decided that I also would like to be on the other side of the table. The IRS position not only gave him a very good job, it also gave him a beautiful wife. Giselle Mehta also is an IRS official. She comes from a very historical family in Mangalore, in Karnataka. Her father was Mr. J.M. Prabhu Lobo, who has been a MP in the 4th Lok Sabha of India. So she comes from a political background as well, and her father was an ICS officer. In those years, it used to not be called as the IAS officers, they were called as the ICS officers. So he was an ICS officer. So she's seen power from her childhood. 10 years they served as IRS officials for the government. They took retirement in the year 2000. They retired as joint commissioners. Both left together. During his education, he has also been a topper in accounts in the Maharashtra University, in the Mumbai University, and after that, he joined cost accountancy. He was a topper there. He became a chartered accountant. He was a topper there. At the same time, when he thought, after practicing as a chartered accountant, when he wanted to becoming an IRS official, he distinguished in that also. Both joined together. Very soon, in 92, they got married. In the year 2000, Mr. Dharmendra Mehta, as you know, is a Gujarati. And every Gujarati, Punjabi, Sindhi, and Marwadi in this country wants to do business. In the year 2000, his educational background motivated him to get into something that he likes: numbers, stocks, and the stock market. And he ventured into business in the year 2000. He and his wife, they have all taken joint decisions together always and all the time. In the year 2000, they took a joint decision, quit the services, and started into the business fraternity. Mr. Dharmendra Mehta is a very responsible businessman as an entrepreneur. He is, apart from doing multiple businesses, he is also on the body of a lot of forums, chambers. He is also involved with the Mangalore Stock Exchange. He has been a director for 8 years. He has also been a part of the Interconnected Exchange of India, based out of Mumbai. He has been advisor to governments on multiple fronts. That's what Mr. Dharmendra Mehta is. Giselle Mehta is not only his partner in business, in the construction, in the power business, and the other activities that he does, but she is also a very successful author. She is an entrepreneur, she is an author with a different mindset, with a different view towards life, and we will listen from her how she thinks on how to lead life and how to be a successful entrepreneur individually as well as a part of a family, as well as a part of being a couple. So that's about Mr. Dharmendra Mehta and Giselle Mehta. Now let's begin with the session. And like I introduced Mr. Dharmendra and Giselle Mehta, let's go straight to the questions. After our session, I will encourage the audience to ask questions. We need to have a lot of takeaways that we can take from their discussions and their answers. So should I begin with the lady first? Ladies first. So as an entrepreneur, as an entrepreneurial couple, what is your participation in the businesses that are being conducted by you?
Well, as you just mentioned, ours is completely consensual decision making. And I think that's such a great tribute that a husband can pay to a wife, that he takes her common sense and her intuition very seriously. The other thing, you did mention that I'm a writer, so one thing I do for all our projects is to write, to first conceptualize what each project is about. For example, our first project was something called the Acropolis, precisely because it was something on a hill, and the Acropolis in ancient Greece, again, was a monument upon a hill. So I conceptualized this very idea of a modern day monument on a hill, and even the architecture and everything else followed. And I wrote such very, very pertinent, almost poetic write-ups that the whole project virtually sold itself. Of course, the quality and other things did speak for themselves.
The minor things were done by Mr. Dharmendra.
The minor things, yes. The eye for the detail, yes. But the grand conception and getting people interested and hooked into what this project is all about, that started with my writing. So you know, the same went for everything else. The next one was called Maximus. I again drew that concept from ancient Rome, meaning something which is maximum. The epitome of enterprise, and sure enough, we managed to get every big financial brand name into Maximus, even the very first foreign bank that raised its shutters in Mangalore. So a lot of it was basically just very clever positioning in terms of words, and thereafter he did the hard work.
That's what husbands generally do, the hard work. Yes, Dharmendra, what can you add to that?
You know, to put it in the IT phrase, you know, she is the software for my business. And I provide the hardware.
Dharmendra, we would like to know, as a couple, when you were engaged with the government department, with the government agencies in this country, what made you get into the entrepreneurship mode? When you were a practicing chartered accountant, you thought that I need to be at the other side of the table and enjoy the power that a government officer wields. So you became a government officer. And after that, what made you come into the entrepreneurship? What motivated you?
See, let me start with your first question. You know, what made me get into the IRS? And that was purely because one particular officer, in the course of conversation, he threw a challenge to me. You know, he started bragging about how difficult it is to pass the UPSC and, you know, blah, blah, blah. I said, okay, fine, I am up to the challenge. Now you tell me how to go about. Because being a Bombayite, you know nothing about how the Indian bureaucracy works. You do not know what UPSC is, you do not know how to get into these exams. I was in the same position, you know, my knowledge about the government services was barely minimal. So I took up the challenge and I was in constant touch with him, and he used to guide me also. He used to tell me, you take this subject, you take that subject, and it will help you. And he was amazed the way I passed. So it was a challenge that was the more inspiring thing for me. Then, you know, just to switch profession, you know.
So the challenge triggered you?
The challenge triggered me.
Fantastic, fantastic. And friends, for your knowledge, one of the largest malls in Karnataka has been constructed by Mr. Dharmendra in Mangalore. And the name of the mall is City Center.
City Center.
It was co-developed by Mr. Dharmendra. And it is a very successful mall which made a lot of international brands, international banks come to a two-tier city like Mangalore. What I would like to ask you is, there are people who are wealth creators and they live in the metro cities of this country. So you talk about successful entrepreneurs in cities like Delhi, Bombay, Calcutta, Chennai. What made you do wealth creation sitting in a two-tier city? Of course, Mangalore is a coastal rich state by itself, a city by itself. But what made you sit there and still do what somebody would have otherwise done in an urban city?
See, I'll break this question into two parts. The first part is when we decided to resign. And, you know, the entrepreneur in me was, you know, I couldn't contain it within myself. You know, it was just about to jump out of my body. But then we were about to decide where to settle down, whether to be an entrepreneur in Mumbai or whether to settle down in Mangalore. So in the course of discussion, what came out, you know, as a consensus opinion, that Mangalore that time, you know, it was a tier 3 city, not even a tier 2 city. And it gave you tremendous opportunity. You know, it was like a, you know, absolutely a virgin area for a lot of developments. So we felt that it would be better chance of succeeding at that late age. And after being set into, you know, bureaucratic way of working in Mangalore rather than in Mumbai. And we were exactly at that point in time, you know, Mangalore was just about to change itself from a town to a city. And we saw that opportunity and we felt, no, Mangalore is the right place for us.
Okay, we have always heard about people hunting for pots of gold at the end of the rainbow. And I think there was quite an important book which said sometimes you can find your pot of gold right on home ground. Now it so happened that we also had our assets which were based in Mangalore. And it seemed like a real shame to let them waste away on a transferable job. So that was one of the reasons where in the end we turned down the metro to be back in our hometown. And as he said, Mangalore was initially like a millstone round his neck. But from this very millstone, he started the foundation stone of his construction business.
I think Dharmendra has got a good choice. Apart from choosing his wife, he also chose the right industries. He chose stock market, he chose real estate, and he chose the
power
industry.
And he said no to airlines.
Now, how he said no to airlines, why he said no to airlines, is something that we would like to understand from both of them. But before that, let me tell you, the money swings in a way in this country and all the countries in the world, where money flows from the stock market to the real estate, to the bullion market, to the stock market, to the real estate. So, did you intentionally plan these business models? And how did you plan it?
No, I was a very keen observer of the financial markets right from the day, you know, of my college, you know. So like when I was in my third year of college, I went and asked my father, you know, I want to invest in the equity market, you know, would you give me money? He said, yes, I'll give you money, but it will have its cost. It's not going to be free. So that taught me the first lesson, you know, money always has its cost. So I said, fine, I'll take the money and I'll repay the cost. He said, it will be 2% per month.
Wow.
And that was pretty stiff. After getting money from him, you know, like, I thought, you know, where to put that money which will give me more than 2%. I went straight into the demography of India. The population is growing. At that point, it was growing at 2.3% per annum. So the simple stock which I identified was Hindustan Lever, which was an FMCG, which was entirely dependent on the demography of India. So if demography is going to grow more than 2.3%, I can easily pay my father 2% interest.
So you have got a very analytical mind. Definitely you're a chartered accountant, and then 10 years service with the government department on an important position definitely makes it more analytical. Your mind becomes more analytical. So I think it was always there in you, doing an analysis and move forward. And how did you connect? When you got out of the services, you first went into the stock market, made money there, and then you ventured into the real estate. You also went into the power industry. My question is, how did you connect these three industries? And my question to Giselle is, how do you mitigate risk in the business decisions that you all take as a couple?
I was about to come to that point. You know, how the real estate, the stock market, the real estate and the bullion market are connected. It's basically the way the economic cycles work and the way the consumer preferences are. Any growth that comes into the economy is easily reflected even before the growth starts into the equity market. Now today we see in the last 1 year the equity markets have gone up by almost 40-50%. It is not that the growth has gone up by 40-50% in the GDP. GDP is still languishing at 5-5.5%. But the prospect of growth which is going to happen has taken the stock markets up. Once the growth kicks in, the automatic beneficiary of the growth, of the generation of employment, of the generation of businesses is into the real estate sector, where the employment brings in the growth into the residential real estate, and the generation of economic activity, the growth in the economic activity brings in the growth in the commercial segment of the real estate. So real estate has to invariably follow the stock market. And that's the last few years, if you reflect, which were the peaks of the stock exchanges and when was the real estate peaking out. You will always see that the real estate has followed the stock market. Whether it is the 92 of Harshad Mehta, or whether it is the 2001 of Ketan Parekh, or whether it was the 2007, which was the economic global boom. The real estate boom is always, it will follow the stock market boom. And if you follow that model, you will be able to catch the first rise, which is a very, very fast, very, very broad-based, and very, very phenomenal rise in all the segments of the market independently. Today you are into the stock market, like 40-50% you have got the raise in the first 1 year. Maybe in the second year also you will be seeing around 20-25% growth. Real estate is sluggish, but you will see real estate kicking in maybe 2 years or 3 years down the line. And once the real estate peaks out, the real estate peaks out at the time when money availability is very easy. When the money circulating in the market is very, very abundant. That's the time real estate peaks out. That's the time when the risk taken is at the highest. And that is exactly the time when the gold is at the lowest. Because the gold gets into, you start investing into the gold when the inflations are low, when the money availability is low, when the economic cycle is peaking out. That's the time you invest in gold. Gold will always give you a benefit 2 years thereafter. So this was my personal experience, and I got onto this, and it gave me my first initial large capital.
And Giselle, how do you mitigate risk when he takes these decisions?
I trust him implicitly because he's so very analytical. I don't think I have to do anything to mitigate the risk. Our decision making may be more on intuitive grounds, on me looking at a larger social picture. But on purely analytical grounds, I trust him implicitly. He really does his homework. He really studies the charts. He really is able to anticipate and look far ahead. He's able to anticipate what kind of demand can take place and how to create the supply to meet that demand. I trust him implicitly.
Fantastic. I think when the power generation business model was flourishing in India, you took a plunge into that also. More so, I feel, because of the advantages that the government was giving, and your calculations on returns of investments were much better compared to other investments where you didn't have to work actively. So what was that thought process which made you get into the power industry, and is it worth getting into the power industry now, in the wind power industry?
See, as any wise investor, you would want to spread your risk across the sectors. Now, the power industry we got into is the wind power. And that was the time when government was giving you financial incentives like tax breaks and various other incentives. And we felt that to spread out the risk, this was the best opportunity. Like if a normal investor has to spread out his risk, where would he invest? After equity, some portion he would put in the fixed income, maybe a debt, maybe fixed deposits. But we felt this is not the right way of spreading out your risk, because still the returns you get from the fixed income will be hardly 8 to 9%. So we looked at the power, wind power especially, as a very good way of spreading out your risk. If your project is approved by the UNFCCC for the clean development mechanism, you were issued carbon credits. And carbon credits were traded at a very hefty valuation those days. It was around 18 euros to 20 euros per carbon credit. And it gave you a phenomenal safe return of 16 to 18% tax-free. Now, which other sector would you give 16 to 18% return tax-free without having much to really, you know, put in efforts into that segment? Because the way this wind energy segment works, you know, there are different original equipment providers for this wind project, like Suzlon is there, Gamesha is there, then there are some others also. So we are with Suzlon. They come out with the concept of a wind farm. You choose how many megawatts you want in that wind farm. They put up the plants for you. You sign a PPA with the government. It's sold to the government. And they take up the turnkey operation and management project for the next 20 years with you. So your personal involvement in day-to-day running the wind farm is very limited. Apart from monitoring your daily generation, if there's a problem, contacting the company people and the O&M people at the site and be in touch with them. Beyond that, your day-to-day management is limited. You can use your time fruitfully for your other businesses.
Dharmendra, what I want to ask is, I've been seeing it from long many years in India, as far as government policy decision-making is concerned, whatever which doesn't work well is always given a tax exemption. When it starts working well, the government will withdraw that tax exemption. And when it runs really well, they start taxing that activity.
That's what precisely
so
the government...
How do you calculate that when you're investing? How do you mitigate that risk?
That's what precisely the government did. They withdrew the accelerated depreciation, fortunately not retrospectively, but only for the prospective wind power generation.
So retrospective is always for Vodafone.
Yeah. Even the 15 years tax exemption on the income, they withdrew only prospectively, not retrospectively, only for the new units. And unfortunately, the carbon credit market collapsed in the last 2 years. because this carbon credit market was governed by the Kyoto Protocol on the clean environment, clean power generation. It was not renewed in the last, in the year 2012, when the period came to an end. We all would have read in the newspapers that at the Davos, this Kyoto Protocol meeting was there and it failed. It didn't come to any conclusive agreement. The minute it failed, the carbon credits rates collapsed in the international market from 18 euros to today it is only 10 cents per carbon credit. So anybody who has any idea of investing in wind power today, it is economically not viable unless and until you are a Japanese investor where your rate of interest is very low for the funds. Because today with the, you know, if you look at the calculations, you will be earning 9% to 10% on your wind power investment, which is way below your rate of borrowing, which will be around 12%. So it's just not economically viable as of today.
Giselle, you also as a family decided to get into the airlines business. You also got a license from the government and you all were on the verge, you all took two aircrafts and you all were on the verge to get them operational. What went wrong? Why didn't you begin? What was the learning in that? As a couple, I'm sure you must have discussed amongst yourselves and got answers.
Yes, in fact, it seemed like a very ambitious thing to do. Of course, a great decision if things worked. But the way we looked at fuel prices skyrocketing and so forth, it just didn't seem viable. Again, the math seemed to be totally loaded against such a very ambitious enterprise. So compared to the big barons with very deep pockets, it seemed to be a wise time to say goodbye to the initial investment, but get out of the business.
So you booked the loss. Dharmendra, what is your take on that?
I'll expand this a little more. We were in touch with a group of entrepreneurs who were earlier with the Air India as flight commanders and pilots, and they came out with this idea that we should start a low cost carrier in Bangalore. That time only Deccan Airways, if you all recall,
yes,
which Kingfisher finally took over, was the only company which had started that plan. And Deccan Airways plan was based on the turbojets. So we came out with this idea that turbojet has a flying limitation. You know, it cannot fly beyond 300 or 400 kilometers. So we came out with an idea that we will go for a jet which will be a low cost, a smaller flight, and it can fly up to 3000 kilometers non-stop. So you could even have a flight from Kerala to Kashmir, non-stop low cost carrier. And this whole project was vetted by Ernst & Young, and they came out with a beautiful project report, and it was all looking very fantastic at that point in time for a simple reason. Crude oil was around $30 per barrel, and at that price everything was looking just too good. By the time we started tying up with the aircrafts, we tied up with the Embraer jets, we signed two Embraer jets on lease. Annual lease was also quite steep that time. And we tied up with Rolls Royce for the engine maintenance and stuff like that. We had the scheduled flight operating license from the DGCA. We tied up with Airport Authorities of India. We had various ties with the Bangalore airport. That time Bangalore had the old airport, not the new one. We had our own software ready for pre-booking, advance booking, everything. Now all these processes took 2 years of time. In these 2 years, crude oil shot up from $30 to $90. Now this is the period I am talking about, 2005-6. And at $90, the whole arithmetic was looking very, very bad. And the model which was looking successful in 2004 at $30, which was a jet, it was not a turbo. Turbo has fuel efficiency, jet does not have fuel efficiency. It started looking absolutely disastrous. By that time, the investment sunk in was almost 12 crores. But it was the time to take a call whether from a billionaire you want to become a millionaire or whether you want to preserve your wealth.
So you booked the loss and you exited the industry.
And it was so difficult for us to take that call because the pilots were appointed, the crew was appointed, training was completed, aircraft were ready to be brought to Bangalore. They were painted with our, you know, logos and everything. The software was ready to, you know, start pre-booking. If we had just said go ahead, we would have started it within 2 weeks of time. And that was the time we took a call. It was that close. And that was the time we took a call. If we go ahead, you know, it's the fastest and surest way from becoming a billionaire to a millionaire. And we said we will stop at this very point.
So what were the learnings in that process? What were the learnings in that process?
The takeaway I get from this is when the figures scream at you and say, no, this is not right, don't stand on your ego. It was a big come down for us in ego terms. You know, because the whole industry knew that we are coming out with this airline. Don't stand on your ego. The figures are screaming at you that this will be a hugely loss-making venture. Cut your losses, be practical, and get out.
Fantastic. I think that is a very big takeaway, that as an entrepreneur, you need to always keep controlling your ego and not just to please the world that you dig holes in your pockets. So I think that's a very, very big takeaway. Giselle, tell me, of all the business ventures that you all have done till now, what excites you the most? Is it power generation? Is it real estate, that is construction? Is it any other industry that you are invested into? What excites you the most and why?
I think construction, because at the end, I'm a person who's hooked on beauty, and what we bring out in the end is extremely aesthetic. And at the same time, you know that you're really transforming lifestyles. You're transforming an entire place. For instance, maybe construction in Bombay is no big deal because there's a huge metropolis here of people wanting to live. But when you give that in a smaller space, you're a magnet for people to move from congested cities, to move back from, say, foreign employments or retirements, and assure them that they're going to have a very good lifestyle. And that is particularly apparent in the mall that we co-promoted. Because you see, people who live in non-metros, they always have that slight feeling of inadequacy compared to people who have lived in metros or those who live in foreign countries. It's always such a point of pleasure to expect and accept gifts from people who come from elsewhere. When you have a mall purveying international brands in a smaller space, it completely transforms the outlook of people. It totally takes their confidence level up. And in itself, it is a magnet for further growth to take place, you know, on the basis of the fact that you have certain facilities in a non-metro. More people are encouraged to come. So you can totally transform a space, a modest space, to one of much higher potential in terms of attracting quality human resources back to perhaps their place of origin and even from elsewhere.
Dharmendra, I would like to ask you one question. When the numbers were screaming at you in the airlines industry, you pulled the plug and you exited. When you built the first mall in Bangalore, the whole country was screaming that mall business is no more profitable. You knew those statistics, you did your study nationally, and even then you went ahead and built the mall. So what was the thoughts behind those decisions?
I will go back a little before the mall. This was the year 2003. When the first wave of liberalization happened in the banking and insurance businesses and telecom businesses. And you could see, you know, various new companies coming into telecom, insurance and various financial products through the banking sector into the big cities like Bombay and Bangalore and various other cities. The simple logic, the simple intelligence told me, finally, if these businesses have to grow and they have to sustain, they have to come out of metros and come into the tier 2 and tier 3 cities. That was the time when I started with Maximus Commercial Complex. It was the first financial center in Mangalore, you know, ever built. Because earlier the concept of a commercial building was, you know, a small commercial building where some small offices of
like
doctors,
building,
you know, doctors, engineers and others would be there. So this was the first concept where I came out with a financial center, where it will be only given to companies which are dealing into the financial sector. And that was the time when everyone in Mangalore told me, see, you have great ideas, you are perhaps overqualified for Mangalore, it may not succeed. But in the end, the economic cycle has to take its shape, and all the big companies, whether they are into insurance or mutual fund or telecom or banking, they all came to Mangalore, and this particular commercial complex was a big success.
And what is your model in that? Do you sell the space or you lease the space?
We first lease the place in the commercial building. And Mangalore, it's a conservative society being a tier 3 city. So people would not take that much risk in buying the premises when it is under construction. People, there are investors who would want a better rate of return than the bank FD if there is a good rental income in a commercial property. Investors are there, because normally in Mangalore, even today, the rental yield itself is around 8 to 9%. Coupled to that, 5 to 6% or 8% capital appreciation of your premises. So even today, the commercial yield in Mangalore is around 14 to 15% without any risk, where you are getting your rental income plus you are sitting on your capital gains.
So you came out with a model where in Bombay people do that, you, it is easier to sell a rented property,
easier to sell a
than
rented
to sell a property and then find a tenant for them. So that's the model that you worked
that's
on.
That's the model we worked on. Now coming to the mall, when we were looking at the shopping habits of Mangaloreans, you know, you talk to any Mangalorean over a social function, you know, oh, I had been to Dubai, I shopped at this mall, I shopped at that mall, oh, I have been to Bangalore or Bombay, new malls have come up. So a lot of conversation was happening about the preferences of shopping of branded products, because that was the time when this consumerism of branded products was just, you know, reaching cities like Mangalore. And we felt that, you know, if we have a large mall, it should eventually work out. All the brands will eventually come to the mall. And the last brand we got, which was just a month back in the mall, was McDonald's. McDonald's stayed away from tier 2 city for all these years, because they still had that preconceived concept that McDonald's will not be successful in a small city. But finally, they have also accepted and they have come to the city center mall.
When you made this mall, what was your fallback plan? Because in Bombay, there are a lot of builders who build malls and then they demolished it and made residential buildings.
No fallback plan in Mangalore. It was a high risk, high return game. You know, like you have in the equity market, you know, if you make it, you make it big. If you don't make it, you know, you tend to lose a lot of money. In Mangalore, if the mall had failed, if we had failed to get the retail brands into the mall, such a large commercial space, because the retail space itself in the mall is 5,40,000 square feet, and we had around 2.5 lakh square feet of car parking area, all put together 8 lakh square feet. There was no way we could have leased out to commercial organizations, like how it happens in Bombay. If a mall closes, there are many other commercial organizations willing to take up that on rental. And the rent that was prevailing in Mangalore for the commercial organizations was hardly 20 to 25 rupees a square foot, which was just not viable for the cost of the mall. So if we had failed, like airline business, we would have got completely wiped out. There was no fallback plan.
I'd also like to tell you that both the mall and the commercial complex, there was some amount of intuiting of the psychology of the people, that there are communities which are totally uncomfortable with bank investments and very much prefer to be in rental income. So that was one of the major factors that sustained the viability of,
because the investment is secured by the asset. Yeah. Because the investment is secured by the asset.
Not only that, they may have some ethical issue with collecting interest from the bank. So this was a form of income, a form of assured income for them. So we could always bank on this particular clientele to come. Of course, after, as he said, the space was leased to a very good brand name. But this clientele can generally be assured. So you also have to be able to read the psychology of the people and reach out accordingly.
As entrepreneurs, what are your differentiators? Every successful entrepreneur has a differentiator in him because of which he is very successful. Because whatever we do, there are so many other people doing it. We are an overpopulated country, so nothing is new, nothing is an invention anymore. So what is the innovation that you do in your business practices that creates a differentiator for others?
See, we bring a few things on the table whenever we do any project, whether it is construction or wind energy or even our future business ventures. A, whether the society wants that project, whether there is a need for that in the society. So like when we started putting up this commercial buildings or malls or various apartments of, you know, boutique apartments, we saw that there was a need in the society for this. This generated a lot of economic activity even in a city like Mangalore. And it was a game changer for Mangalore. Because today the mall itself is doing around, you know, the last year, the figures we have, it has done 600 crores of turnover in a single mall.
Wow.
And that's a huge turnover for Mangalore. And seeing the city center success, you know, Prestige Group, which is Bangalore-based group, which is a listed company on the National Stock Exchange, they started a mall in Mangalore. Now, their mall has just opened a couple of months back, whereas City Center opened 4 years back. So, seeing the success of City Center, Prestige Mall has come to Mangalore. And if you go back and check out with these two brands, one is the lifestyle brand, and before that, lifestyle and spa, we had to literally plead and beg with them to come to Mangalore. They are saying, no, 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 we are into very big cities. We have not gone into so many other big cities. How can we come to Mangalore, you know, out of all places? We gave them a model which they simply could not refuse. Spa, we said, we will have a revenue sharing starting from 4% of the revenue sharing, where the revenue sharing will be as low as 4% if you achieve a particular turnover. If your turnover is higher, 5%. If it's higher, 6%. With those kind of rentals, we got them into Mangalore. Today, Spar has been taken over by Auchan. Auchan has the highest per square foot turnover in India in City Center Mall.
And you benefit the most out of it.
And because of our model, today our rental yield in that shop is around 9%, where we gave them an offer as low as 4% if they didn't do well. And lifestyle also is doing exceedingly well in City Center Mall. Auchan was doing so well that they have taken one more store in Prestige Mall. In our mall, it is around 48,000 square feet. In Prestige Mall, they have taken around 38,000 square feet. They are doing that well in Mangalore.
Wow, fantastic. So you always knew to put the offers in the right years, and you are sure that they will be successful, which will drive your revenues. So that is another study that you always do before getting customers. What, according to you, is entrepreneurial success, Giselle?
I think it's being able to anticipate demand and then effectively create it if necessary to build it up. For example, at the time that we were foraying into construction, it also took some preliminary homework on our part to, as he said, study the charts and so forth, and then communicate these findings of ours in very simple layman's language in various journals and newspapers so that people could understand that this is what is going to happen next, that this is a good area of investment to be in. And it was very surprising that once these ideas kind of got round, after a while people themselves would kind of get back to us and say, no, 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 we hear that real estate is really the place to be in. So it was these ideas that had got around very subtly into people's consciousness.
So you nurtured all those ideas.
Yeah, so you nurtured them. You have to have confidence in your ability to look ahead and get ready with your supplies so that in the meanwhile, the consciousness of people works to accept what is going to come.
You are an avid golf player, Dharmendra. What does golf teach you as an entrepreneur?
Golf is a game. Once you fall in love with golf, you know, there's no divorce in that love. And it's an unforgiving game. There is no margin of error in that game. You know, deceptively looks very easy when you watch on TV, but the margin of error there is virtually zero. Now, as an entrepreneur, if you, you know, borrow that philosophy out of golf, that your margin of error in any decision should be as close to nil as possible, you will be definitely be successful in any venture you do.
What is your take on expanding businesses? Would you like to expand businesses by hiring more people directly under your employment? Or would you like to expand your businesses by hiring organizations? That is outsourcing your activities to organizations and grow. What is your wealth multiplication formula?
We have always learned one thing in life. The more time you have in, you know, at your hands, the more effectively you can use that time for doing larger businesses. Outsource is the key for the success. And outsourcing the right kind of people is very, very important. The ethics what you have for your business, the same ethics and the same principles have to go down with your people whom you are outsourcing. I'll give you one example. For the construction industry, I wanted to follow all the rules and regulations, especially with the labor laws. And when I looked around, nobody was following labor laws. Nobody was following any provident fund things. Nothing was followed. It was so difficult to even get a contractor who would follow all these rules and regulations. So I have a legal cell in my office just to help all these outsourced contractors to see that they follow the labor laws, to see that they pay provident fund to all their employees, to see that all the worksmen compensation insurance is taken for all the employees who are working at our site, to see that all the employees who are working at our site has the labor welfare registration card, so that the whatever benefit government has to pass on to them reaches them. Now, once you start with this kind of a philosophy, it slowly translates down and all your ethics will be followed by your subcontractors. And you feel the difference in a way that you are not compromising with your social values, with your ethics when you are outsourcing. And that is the most important factor I feel I have done in this.
So on 1st of January 2013, this couple went vegan. And when they went vegan to an extent where they even stopped investing in the stocks of companies which were promoting animals, food or whatever.
Or animal testing.
Animal, whatever related to non-veg or whatever. So I think this is being extremist in business as well as in thoughts and as well as in actions, that you are vegan to an extent that even things which you cannot control, you be away from that and create a different lifestyle. So what is the thought behind doing that?
Okay, I think I'll answer this one. Now, many of you would be aware, or perhaps I constantly see this on social networks, this particular line from this book called The Secret, Rhonda Burns, that, you know, the whole universe conspires with you for success. Many people see that, okay, you just dream and the universe will conspire with you for success. So first and foremost, the question I asked myself is, what is this universe and why should it conspire with each other or with me for success? And it was something that defied definition. Is it a galaxy you're talking about, or the Milky Way, the universe, the planets and the sun? And there was no answer, but what I felt was most likely is that this very earth that we're living in with all its creatures, and its creatures, most of them, are suffering in many ways due to human abuse. So just why would these creatures of the universe conspire with each other for the success of a random individual? So I decided to break that negative energy cycle with a very conscious decision in my consumption habits, my diet, my lifestyle generally. And I have to say that it has invited enormously positive energies in my life, which has spilled over into everything else, including business, including relationships, including everything else. So the positive energy can exist, but it has to be something from you. You yourself have to become an entity of positive energy. You cannot expect it to come from outside. You have to generate it with your conscious will, with your determination to do the right thing. And believe me, it works. It really does help you in every aspect of your functioning, whether it's on the personal front or whether it's on the corporate front. You have to believe me that the roller coasters in your life simply seem to ease out with this, probably because we become peaceful and full of equilibrium and inner harmony.
Lovely. So I think with that, that was my last question. Let us open the questions to the audience.
Hello.
Yes, Nagu.
You obviously do a lot of homework before you take a decision. And right through, it looks like you're a lovely risk taker. You love to take risks. At those times, you know, forget the audience, forget the people. You will be questioning yourself, did I take the right decision? Did I do the right analysis? And if I did, now here comes the question. At that point, would you agree that you took a wrong decision? Or would you start saying, I need to think differently moving forward?
See, I'll start with the first thing. Self-belief is the most important factor in any decisions you take. If you start doubting your own self, you know, at any stage in your life, you will never be able to take the right decision. The facts have to be unbiasedly, unequivocally be analyzed. You know, there should be no personal subjective opinion getting into it, no egos getting into it, nothing of that sort. Like in the stock investments also, we have cut our losses in so many things with very unbiased, unequivocal decision making. That this is not working out, I have gone wrong here, or I might not have gone wrong here, but things have changed thereafter. And now it's a time to revisit the decision, get out of it. Like we did in Air One, when we started, the business model was not wrong. At $30 a barrel crude oil, it was a very good business model. It was vetted by, you know, Ernst & Young also. But when the crude oil shot up to $90, and subsequently once we decided to close down, it even shot up to $140. And then the global meltdown came in, again crude oil came down. But at that point in time, it was not my first decision was wrong. My first decision was still very right. It was a very promising field. But at 90, we reviewed the decision, and because we had the self-belief that the decision now, what I am taking is the right decision based on the current facts and figures available, I have to go for it. So self-belief is the key word to this.
Fantastic. Yes, Kunal, you have a question. Yes. So you have to be ruthless with your own decisions.
You have to be.
Fantastic. Yes, Kunal.
Very good evening, sir. I have two questions for you. First, what happened to your CA practice? Because as I've just started my law practice, I've invested so much time and heart into it, I can't let it go even if there's a very good opportunity. So how did you convince yourself?
I'll tell you where it has helped me on being a chartered accountant. In the last 12 years of my business career, I have never been visited by a huge income tax demand. So you can always apply your knowledge. You know, it is never going to
go. Was it because of your knowledge or because of your colleagues?
To a certain extent, both. But let me tell you, my life philosophy is never believe three set of people. Always use your own intelligence to that. A is your chartered accountant, B is your lawyer, C is your doctor.
Always take a second, a third, and a fourth opinion. Is that excellent? Next question, please.
You look very much organized and analytical. What do you think the role of manipulation in business? Is it required to manipulate things? I'm not saying 100%. But what is the role?
And we expect a practical answer, not a philosophical one.
Yeah, okay. I'll break your question into two parts. A, whether you would like to manipulate others. B, whether you would allow others to manipulate. Both ways it works in businesses. First part is, profit is not the only reason why you do business. There's a huge social responsibility on each of us as an entrepreneur. It's a responsibility to look after our society, our employees, and by contributing fairly and squarely to the revenues by paying proper taxes. When I started construction in Mangalore, there was a 50-50 going on in Mangalore in the real estate. And from an ex-IRS officer, for me, 595 was also difficult. So I started doing my real estate with 100% check payment, which was a very difficult job to push into a market which is used to 50-50. But over a period of time, it worked out. So So manipulation, when it comes to you, do not allow it. Sometimes you can get manipulated by others, and that happens when your homework is weak, when you do not have self-belief, you will allow others to manipulate, which will definitely take you in the wrong direction. Say like bribing some people, or you know, getting your work done in a shortcut manner, or evading taxes in a large way based on some advice given by some professionals. Do not allow even that to creep into your businesses. The minute you walk on that path, you know, your businesses will slow down because your mind will be working more on that. How much you are manipulated, how to come out of it, how to safeguard yourself from those manipulations. And you will lose your focus. You will lose your sight from your own enterprises.
Yeah, Geeta, you have a question.
Your city center project, if you take, and with your analytical thinking, is a huge risk you took in terms of a tier 3 and a 8 lakh square feet, and where you had to bring in the shift and in the consumerism as well as the clients, and everything was a big risk. So were you able to take the risk because you're a co-promoter and your not much of money was not on the table, but more of efforts was there and you were willing to do that? Or you also had money put on the table and it was that kind of a risk?
Any business will have the funds requirement, and you have to really look at what is your funds requirement and at what stage you need these funds. We were successful enough in bringing investors at different level of construction of the project, which mitigated our total fund flow into the project from our sources. And that also mitigated the risk involved in the project. Because if you have understood the mall concept, you start signing letter of intent. The very first stage of, you know, when your first slab comes up, the letter of intent you start signing. So we were very successful in signing a letter of intent with a lot of brands, you know, whether they are vanilla brands or, you know, anchor brands. And that gave confidence to our investors to bring in money into the mall. And that mitigated the risk to a certain extent.
Lovely, lovely. Yeah, Rohit.
Today it's all about, you know, tying up and, you know, collaborative efforts on that. So how do you, know, do the tie-ups based on the philosophies that we match, or based on the merit of the business, or the combination of both? And if philosophies don't match, still the business potential is much higher, then how do you take the call?
See, I'll give you one example. There was a particular fallow land available in Mangalore, which was basically nothing but the riverbed area, which was privately owned by various farmers. And we had a very interesting offer there by a panchayat leader of that particular village. And this is in the heart of Mangalore. It is only 8 kilometers from the railway station of Mangalore. But because of very poor connection and networking of the roads, it was, you know, like an inaccessible area. But there our philosophies and our social responsibilities came in. And even though we were getting that land at 8 lakhs an acre in the year 2003, we still declined that offer. We still declined that collaboration with that particular panchayat leader to pool the land for us, take it from the farmers and give it to us. Because we felt that socially that was not the just thing to do. And financially it was a very, very wrong decision to let that opportunity go by. And the facts today justifies that it was a financially very wrong decision. But socially, even today I know it is a very, very right decision. Because the people who have bought that land, today they have still not got the permission to start construction on it. But the City Corporation of Mangalore has already passed the resolution to bring that area within the City Corporation. Once that happens, all this area will go for development. What will happen is, when the rivers get flooded, these were the areas where the water would spread out. Once these areas are filled up and developed, the city of Mangalore, which has never seen flooding till this date, will start seeing in the near future. And that was the social risk which we did not want to take, and we did not want to collaborate.
Was that a tough call?
It was a very tough one, very, very tough one.
Fantastic. Last question is Sylvester.
Dharmendra, Giselle, thank you for sharing your thoughts. What about Generation Next and what part of your family is involved in your business?
I think that my wife will answer.
Can you come again?
Generation Next.
Okay, we have two bright sparks. We have a son who's doing his master's in the UK and we have a daughter. So I think with Generation Next, we would probably be able to explore a lot of new opportunities. For instance, I myself am looking forward to being in a lot of vegan businesses. As he mentioned, I'm a vegan, so I'm very much into innovating in different things in areas of food, perhaps cosmetics, even the use of fabrics. I was quite delighted to hear that someone's into coconut oil, because I'm one of those who's an ardent opponent of palm oil. So I hope to see a lot more of things like agribusinesses rooted in India taking off. And I would very much like to partner with my daughter once she's done with her studies in areas like this. We also have a very bright son, so a lot of new possibilities emerge with what their interests are. So at this point, this is something tentative I have for myself, but probably my son and his father have their own their own plans. There's a bit of a gender divide here between our gravitations and theirs.
No, that's fine. It's in every family.
And I would like to say that in terms of this Gen Next that you're talking about, we are very involved parents. Now, earlier this year, for instance, I had some commitments with one of my children. She was in her final year of school and had a school leaving examination. I had two very important commitments. I had an opportunity to lecture in the University of Melbourne, and I had another opportunity to go to a non-conventional PAR conference in Dubai in April. But thanks to my great involvement with the next generation, who I said should be brought up to potential, I felt it's okay, I can defer this to some other point of time, but for them it's crucial. It is an opportunity for them to really reveal themselves. So sometimes I may take a back seat on my own personal ambitions if I feel that Gen Next requires that kind of involvement. But that gives him all the more freedom, I think, to push ahead with whatever he wants to do. So that's how we keep the balance.
So that's a balancing game.
That's a balancing game, exactly.
Now Giselle is planning to invest in one vegan restaurant in Bangalore. It's called The Carrots, and it's in Koramangala. And the people who have promoted this restaurant, they are from the IT background. And they have left their jobs and they have started this restaurant, but the restaurant is bleeding every month. So as of now, the restaurant is making losses, but Giselle is very committed. And I still do see, you know, some potential, maybe not immediately, but maybe 2 years, 3 years down the line, that this will become a successful restaurant. And once it becomes a successful restaurant in one city, one location, it can be multiplied later on to larger cities. You know, it can come to Bombay, it can come to Chennai. So she is starting her first foray into that investment.
I believe that it isn't just your profits and bottom line which counts. You have to make a difference. You have to make a change in the world for the things that you care about. And to that extent, I don't mind sacrificing money here and there, but I'd really want to see significant change. I want to see a better world. So that is the intuition and that is the extra factor that we bring to our business. I think I largely see myself as a karmic partner in all this. I see myself as a metaphysical management person. I kind of dwell more in areas of intuition that this is the right thing to do, where even if it doesn't really translate immediately into the bottom line, I somehow sense that the opportunities will come, that the profits will come in some other way, and it's always worked for us, believe me.
Lovely.
So that's, whenever that's you are in Bangalore, do visit Carrots.
Mr. Matthias.
Yeah.
This is the last
question. You are build up your business brick by brick by your own efforts. What is your ideas of acquisition and mergers for your economic growth?
That's a difficult question, because I'll tell you our philosophy of business, then I'll answer it through that. Even today, we are a debt-free company. All our investments have been either funded by us or funded through the investors who eventually get their spaces or whatever. whether we are in power generation or we are in construction, we are totally debt free. So we have not believed in leveraging, and this comes because of our bureaucratic background. Bureaucracy makes you somewhat little conservative also. And bureaucracy teaches you one thing: take calibrated risk, not blind risk. So somewhere we are still keeping those lessons learned from bureaucracy into our way of businesses. So we have not gone into acquisition or merger of any enterprises as of now. But what I am looking for as my next business opportunity is to buy an existing manufacturing industry, either based in Mangalore or Bangalore, and try to either existing profit making or maybe even struggling because of finances, to see the opportunity in that, take over that company and try to make it a successful company. So that's my next venture. As Giselle's next venture will be in the vegan side, mine will be in the manufacturing side.
Fantastic, fantastic. I think that is the conclusion, and there are still people wanting to ask questions. We'll make it quick.
This question is being asked by one of my friends who's watching this event live online. His question is, what according to you is the next big business to get into?
He's already into the biggest businesses in the country.
And anything that can be scalable. I have seen one thing in businesses which have grown, in a big, big way, whether it is the concept of, KFC or Walmart or even in India, Flipkart. Whatever you can scale it up in a very short time, in a very large way, that's the business you should get into, whether it is online or it is offline. Whatever way you want to go about with that business, it should be scalable. If it is scalable, you will really hit a jackpot.
Yes, the last question, somebody?
This last question is by Siddharth Bhimani, who's watching this, the live telecast of this.
He's a very active attendee, yeah. Today he's sick, so he's at home.
So his question is that, should we invest in stocks once some news regarding it comes out in media? Because they are very fluctuating at that time and also attractive.
Never invest on rumors and news, because there are smarter people than us who have already got into that share, that particular investment, much before that. Always invest based on the fundamentals and not based on the news.
Fantastic. Hemal, last question. This is my fifth last question.
So you are into multiple businesses, so you will have to sublet, you must be subletting work to people. So how do you believe in them? Do you believe in them completely and let them do their job? Or it's very difficult to swap businesses, I suppose. So do you believe in your staff completely and let them do what they do, or you keep a check always? And how do you do that?
See, when you hire a particular staff, a new staff, in a very responsible position, you start believing him in a very calibrated manner. You don't give all the responsibilities directly to him. So you also get time to gauge him and to judge him, how far you can trust him. So like today, I have my chief accountant. I can even keep my blind sign checks with him. When I travel abroad, a lot of payments have to be made here. I am so confident about him that I give him signed blank checks, not even crossed, and he fills in the details. And of course, he scans it and sends me by email as and when he keeps issuing. So I keep track of all the checks issued online. But that's the confidence you get only after that staff has worked for you for a few years. You trust confidence, you put your confidence in him too early, that's a risk you may be taking.
I think I'll expand that a little bit. His is still a very highly personally involved, hands-on approach. And even where there are people who are qualified, like engineers, architects, lawyers, you can still find him really immersed and trying to find new solutions, which often quite fox the experts in that very field. And that is one of the outcomes of being in bureaucracy. When nothing is off bounds, you try and get to the bottom of everything so that you're on top of the situation. So that is the final style that works.
A combination
of wise delegation, at the same time, hands-on supervisory approach.
Fantastic. So I think with that, we come to the end of the session. And can somebody just get this removed from here? I would like to request Mr. Kamath to come up. And we will give mementos to our guests today who have shared their experiences, the plaques. Mr. Kamath, can I also request Mr. Subhash to come up? Thanks a lot, Dharmendra and Giselle. That was very brilliant. And thanks a lot for sharing everything that you experienced in your business career. Please. Mr. Kamath. One for the photo. And for the mugs, I would like to request our first couple at Inspiring Conversations, Mr. and Mrs. Nagu. Come.